Hello and welcome to FairTube. Great news today, folks. YouTube actually has carefully announced through existing contacts that they do plan to come back to our formal request to enter into negotiations before the deadline runs out. So that would be next week. We're looking forward to that. But it is yet unofficial, and therefore right now we have to stay alert. But they actually have responded to the press, and we got a ton of press. Like almost 50 different articles in newspapers from all around the world, I think from 9 different countries. So they have issued a statement, and we would like to dissect this now in this little video with our comebacks. And I will do that slingshot channel style. And my colleague Six Silverman from the IG Metal will do it in his far more professional ways. And I think that will well balance out. So here we go.
I'm Six Silverman. Today we're recording in the headquarters building of IG Metall in Frankfurt, Germany. We're still waiting for an official response from YouTube, but they've made at least one statement about our proposal to the press. It was published in an article by Mason Sands in Forbes magazine. Today we're going to go through this statement, one sentence at a time.
We also need to ensure that users feel safe and that advertisers feel confident that YouTube is safe for their brand.
So YouTube, did you even watch our video? I mean, our demands are in no ways reducing the safety on the site, not for anyone involved. What we want is transparency, we want more fairness, and we want a decent communication style. How can that be dangerous? I mean, the only thing that is in danger here is your ultimate position of power, so you can do what you want and then refer to rules that you have chosen not to publish.
Of course, nobody is debating that. YouTube serves the function of a public sphere, and in a public sphere, everyone deserves to feel safe. Of course, creators would also love to feel safe in the knowledge that they know the rules of the game that determine their livelihoods. Since YouTube's spokesperson used the word safe, let's talk a little bit more about safety. How many brand managers have had their mental health suffer because of the lack of transparency of YouTube's algorithms? Maybe a couple, but probably not that many. After all, their bosses know that when ads are run against inappropriate videos, it was probably not the brand manager's fault. But the consequences of this lack of transparency for creators' mental health are increasingly well documented. And until YouTube tells creators the rules of the game, we cannot believe that they take creators' well-being seriously. Advertisers can see exactly which videos their ads appears on. Don't creators deserve the same transparency?
We take lots of feedback as we work to get this balance right, including meeting with hundreds of creators every year.
Oh, hundreds of creators you talk to. Wow, wow. What a big number. Is Will Smith one of them, maybe, by any chance? In fact, I am one of these creators, and I've been actually talking to YouTube for about a year and a half now. It's lots of blah blah, but nothing ever came out of that. So there's no result, and this has to end. I think the only way how YouTube will move is if we apply pressure, and that is exactly what we're doing.
That's good. But hundreds of creators is really a drop in the ocean. The YouTubers Union is just getting started, and we have 21,000 members. Here are a couple questions. Which creators is YouTube talking to? Is it mostly the celebrities who are already getting their content pushed on the platform and who have different rules for what they're allowed to put in their videos without being demonetized? What does YouTube talk about with these creators that they talk to? What effect do these discussions have on decisions that are made about the platform? Why do some creators get heard while thousands of others can't even talk to a human being about a demonetization decision? YouTube says that they're working to get the balance right, but talking about this situation as striking a balance misses the point. In California, where I come from, the highway speed limit in cities is 65 miles per hour. We can only discuss whether this number is too high or too low because we know what the number is. On YouTube, all we know is that for most creators, there appears to be a speed limit. It's probably somewhere between 25 and 100 miles per hour. But we don't know what it is exactly because YouTube won't say. YouTube has the right to decide what the speed limit is. It even has the right to say for some creators it's going to be different. But we want to know what it is.
However, contrary to what is being claimed, YouTube creators are not employees by legal status.
Right, for sure, we aren't employees. So we don't get minimum wages, we don't get vacation, we don't get social benefits. Very comfortable for you, isn't it? But guess what? We aren't independent video producers either. In fact, we are completely depending on YouTube. We are at your mercy. We actually have to follow your mysterious ways. You kick us around, you destroy our work without even so much as an explanation for it. You know, independent video production companies usually have lots of customers. And do you think that if we would have an alternative, we would really stick around for just one day longer? You know, that's an illusion. We only stay on YouTube because there is no alternative. So, we aren't employees, but we aren't partners either. What are we? You know what, YouTube? Slavery has been abducted a long, long time ago. I think in most, if not in all, the countries that you are active in.
It would, of course, be very illuminating for us to see YouTube's legal analysis of this question. But one thing is clear. YouTube's guidelines let YouTube control creators in ways that are not consistent with the traditional freedoms of truly independent contractors. Most creators are not really independent businesses with a bunch of different clients, beside YouTube, acting in an open market with fair competition. The lack of transparency around monetization and search and discovery mean that the market is not open. We know that competition on the platform is not fair. The data that we have, for example, suggests very strongly that content from big corporate channels is shown much more often in trending than content from independent creators. And YouTube explicitly prohibits creators from embedding their own ads in videos. So there are serious limitations on the independence of YouTube creators. Really, YouTube, like Uber and Lyft, gets the best of both worlds. It doesn't have any of the responsibilities it would have if it hired creators as employees. But it still gets extremely fine control over content, and it gets to impose certain non-compete restrictions, which aren't really consistent with the idea of independent businesses competing fairly in an open market. Creators, on the other hand, have the worst of both worlds. They don't have any of the protections they would have if they were employees, but neither do they have the freedom of truly independent contractors. YouTube can make a huge step towards solving these problems really easily. Give creators more transparency. Tell creators the rules.
So, folks, that was our little comeback. I hope you enjoyed it. And stay tuned, because we might have very exciting news for you next week. Thanks, and bye-bye.